Good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Think My Think Ministry, Church of God in Christ. I am the pastor and prophet, Mary Washington, servant to the Most High God and servant to you, the people of God, worldwide. And I am delighted to come today with a veteran moving, a yoke-destroying word from the Lord. Today we talk more about the last days, and our topic is the Bible view of perilous times. We believe that we, the people of God, need to hear specifically what God is saying as he speaks of the last days so that you can be comforted as well as know what to do. So we want to encourage you to get your Bible, your pen and your paper, and get ready. God is going to give revelation knowledge as we study his word. Before we go into the word, we want to listen to the rest of this song, and then we'll have our prayer, and we'll begin our study. Stay with us. God bless you. God can, and I know he will. Everything that God has said is yes and amen. God has said it, and it's a done deal. Again, we welcome you to Feed My Sheep Ministries, Church of God in Christ, and this opportunity to share a word with you from Pure Word for everyday Christians. This word here is purposed to strengthen you to become who it is God will have you to be. And there's only one way, child of God, that that can happen. That is in your obeying the word of God. Receiving the word of God in your heart and walking in it. That's the only way. Of all the other things and ways that you try, everything else will fail miserably except your being obedient to the word of God. And so as we look at the last days, which so many are concerned about today, we're going to talk about it from the Bible perspective. Oftentimes when we're talking about things that are going on or things that we're concerned about in our society, we start to speak out of our flesh, how we feel, how we think, and how we see it. And it takes us away from what the word of God has said. And so we're going into the scripture, in particular, Second Timothy, the third chapter, and we're going to see what the scripture tells us that is going to be going on in the last days. And much of it we've already witnessed, but much is also still going on, and there's much to be expected. So now we need to know, what do we do? As believers, as children of God, what do we do to stand in this last and evil day? God has sent his word to help us understand what is going on in this last day hour and how we are to be prepared to stand against it from every perspective. You know, many times we're looking at different situations and we're just looking at it from one perspective or from one side, but there are many things that are going on in your life and in this earth realm that needs you to look at it from a different perspective, to see what really is going on, to see the whole of the thing. And the only way you're going to see that is looking into the Word of God. So I pray that you have gotten your Bible and whatever you're going to take notes with, because God is going to give revelation. You want to jot it down so that you can think about it and meditate on it, and then make application as the scripture has prescribed in your life, so that you'll be one that's standing in the place that glorifies God in this hour. Let's go to the throne of God, and then we will go into the Word. Father God, we say thank you for your goodness and for your mercy, for your Word that is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We just thank you, give you glory and praise for the revelation that you're about to pour out through your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise the name of the Lord again. I'm just delighted to share this Word with you. I was meditating on last night and even this morning, what would I share with the children of God in this millennial hour? I truly believe that every born-again believer right now is a millennial night. And we're being impacted by the things that are going on in this millennial era. And so we must be prepared, as the scripture has told us. It's for every age group, but I think in particular about those who fall in that group of 18 to 45, and how so many things has happened to that would in a way condemn your life if you don't receive the revelation of the scripture, if you don't get the Bible view of the perilous times, so that you'll know how to combat these things that are coming against you. So I want you to go with me to 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, and we're going to begin there, and I'm going to read in the King James Version. In fact, I may go between the King James and the New International Version, because some of it speaks in a way that I like to share. And so I want you to go with me to hear what is being said. In the King James Version, 2 Timothy 3 and 1, Paul is writing to Timothy, and he says this to him as one who's teaching him and preparing him to be ready for this last hour. He says, "This know also." So Paul is continuing teachings that he had been given him to help him to be a good instructor, as well as to live holy and acceptable unto God as a living epistle. So now he says, "This know also." I'm going to give you something else to go with what I've already told you, that in the last days, perilous times will come. Now, many of us have heard that scripture, and we don't go any further in the reading of the passage, because we've got an understanding that perilous times will come. Well, I want to talk a little bit about what it means to have perilous times, and then help you identify some of the things that are going on today in our society, as well as things that are going on in your home, in your body, in your mind, in your environment, in your family, because these are all indications that we are in the last days and the perilous times. Another word for perilous is terrible. Terrible times, terrible. And most of us can quickly identify with that, because no matter which way we look, we see things that are contrary to what we desire them to be. Well, consider this, child of God. If it's contrary to what you desire it to be, certainly it's going to be contrary, and you got the right mindset, it's going to be contrary to what God would desire it to be. And this is really why Paul is sharing this with Timothy, to let him know the mindset of man, as man has walked away from God, doing their own thing, reverencing one another, or reverencing themselves, but have a lack of reverence for God. These terrible times, or these perilous times that the scriptures say, are going to show up in this earth realm. One of the things that I've learned as being one who seeks the face of God daily and have a hunger and a thirst for him and made the decision I'm going to live holy and acceptable to him, that even in all of that, I am not exempt from the terrible times. I'm not exempt from the perilous times. My family is hit with the perilous things as well, and others who would serve God with their whole heart, they're dealing with the perilous times as well, because it's going on in this earth realm. And while we have a covering to keep us and help us and guide us and cause us to be victorious, we are not exempt from the aspect in this earth realm of these perilous times. So what we want to do is to see what the scripture is declaring is going to be going on in these perilous times. Again, I think about how oftentimes we don't get an understanding. And the Bible has told us in Proverbs, the fourth chapter, that wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, we want the wisdom of God to show us and guide us, but with all thy wisdom, get understanding. We need an understanding of what's being said. Sometimes we make it too complicated trying to show how much we know, and we're not accepting God's word at face value. What did he mean when he said it? Why was did he give us a certain word? And we will find that God gives us his word so that we can prepare for whatever it is that is coming against us. He gives us his word so that we can lay hold on whatever it is that we are desiring of him. He gives us his word so that we will know that we have a solid foundation to stand on, trusting in him with all our heart and not leaning to our own understanding. And so it's just as valuable for us to understand what is going on in this last day that's affecting us from various perspectives as it is for us to understand how do we get more money, how do we get the blessing, how do we get the healing, how do we get the deliverance. We need a full understanding of all things as God has provided it for us. The scripture tells us in the book of Romans, the first chapter, that God would not have us to be ignorant. He don't want you ignorant. But a lot of times we run in ignorance because we're looking for the sensationalism rather than a simple, plain word from the Lord. And so today I want to share this with you, simply going through the scripture and showing you things that you already see but perhaps don't recognize because it hasn't been revealed to you. And many of these things, if you don't recognize it, you will be a partaker of it. You'll be a part of it, and you'll be in this group of people that Paul is speaking of, and you won't even know you're there because you haven't heard the word. See, that hearing the word is very important to us as believers because we hear the word, and then we follow after. Whatever God tells us to do, we do. Whatever he tells us not to do, we do not do. But if you're doing the opposite of that, you're in a very wretched place. And this is why so many times people get burnout or frustration or aggravation in trying to live holy because they've got this mindset of what they think it is. They become the prophet to themselves without hearing a word from God. But I want you today to take the time and let's listen to see what God has said in his word through his prophet. 2 Timothy 3 and 2 reads, "For men shall be lovers of their own selves." Now, it has a comma there. I personally believe that if it had been a semicolon there, and I'm not trying to rewrite the scripture, but if it had been a semicolon there, that statement would have covered everything else that Paul is about to say. Because this is the issue. Then, today, and even in the future, for the person who falls in this category, where they are lovers of their own selves. See, the Bible has told us to love God with all our heart, all our soul, all our strength, and all our might, and all of our mind, and to love our neighbor, our brethren, as ourselves. But what the greater number of people have done is taken God out of his position. Even those that are professing to be children of God, Christians, saying they're laboring in the kingdom of God, they've taken God out of his position as Lord of all, themselves in that place, and they began to worship themselves. And that's the place the person is in when they are lovers of themselves. Because when you become a lover of yourself, then it's all about you, about what you feel, about what you think, about how you see it, and you actually displace God. You've displaced others. You're not following after what God said all things hinges on, the two and greatest commandments, loving God with all your heart and loving your neighbor as yourself. You have become your God. And so it's real important that you hear this word as we go through seeing what it looks like when one becomes a lover of themselves more than a lover of God. And I like to say it like that because it helps people to understand that they need to look and see that the issue is they have put themselves as Lord of their life, as God of their life. So it goes on in the scripture, says, "For men shall be lovers of their own selves." And then it began to list various things: covetous, coveting what somebody else has. Lovers of money. That's the translation for covetousness, lovers of money. And if we stop right there, we would find that many people who are at the church, who are professing saved, who have went to the altar and cried and shouted and danced, they're in a place, a state of being lovers of money. Why? Because they're lovers of themselves, and the issues of life or the trials of life has dimmed their focus, and where they're looking for what about me? What can fix me? What do I need? What do I want? And that oftentimes it's mostly what do I want? And so they have become lovers of money because they believe that money is the answer to everything. If the average person that you speak with, that's their mindset. And yes, somewhere down the list of things, they'll add being saved in there or being filled with the Holy Ghost in there. But most people, their main concern is money. Now, how do I know that? Let me prove that to you. When you ask most people, what do they want in life? They do not start with having a right relationship with God. They do not start with fulfilling God's will in ministry. They do not start with anything that has to do with God. But what they will start with is the houses and the cars and the mate and the things that fulfill their flesh needs. That tells us that people have become lovers of themselves. Lovers of themselves. And if you are one, when you begin to think of, like, what can I do? What do I want to accomplish in this earth realm? And it starts off with the natural things that you desire, which God doesn't mind you have them. He wants you to have them. But he does not want you to desire those things ahead of him. In fact, in Scripture, it talks about God being a jealous God and how God will not give his glory to another. And oftentimes we're getting our new cars and our new homes and our new jobs and, you know, all of these things that we're desiring in the flesh, and we have put them in place of God. You know, I start to say in front of God, and truly we have because we've chosen them over God, but we've also replaced God with them. They become our God. And the Bible talks much about idolatry and how man made other things their God rather than God. And this is what Paul is speaking of here as he speaks to Timothy, warning him of what to expect. And I come today warning you of what to expect. As people will be lovers of themselves and lovers of money, you must be careful and aware. That's why the Bible tells us to watch and pray. You must be aware that you yourself do not go into that place of being lovers of yourself and lovers of money. Because what it'll do, it'll distort your relationship with God. And so as we talk about the last days and what we ought to do, the Bible view of perilous times, one of the first things we see in this scripture coming directly from the scripture is that men will be lovers of themselves and then they will be covetous. So what does that tell you and I? If this is a warning, if this is a warning about to make a person aware of what's going to be happening in the last days, what does it tell you and I? It tells us, firstly, that we do not become lovers of our own self. We stay with what God has said in his word, what all things hinges on, these two commandments that I just quoted a few moments ago, loving God with all our hearts and loving our neighbors ourselves. We got to stay with that. If we don't stay with that, you went away from God. You remember in the book of Revelation, as God has sent a word, given Jesus a word, and Jesus sent this word by the angels to John, and John penned it down about the church of Ephesus and how they were busy about the business that they thought they ought to be in. Jesus sent them a word. I'm going to go to that scripture if I can find it right quick. He sent them a word to let them know that you're doing some good work. The problem is you've left your first love. They had walked away from what it is that God had given them to do. He gives them a great commendation for all the acts. Let me read that. In Revelation 2:2, it says,